You ever just look at an artist producer and think to yourself, "Oh yeah, well I know what to expect." Of course you don't, you're normal people, what am I talking about? Anyway, that's the relationship I seem to have with Jay Joyce. Not really just quality or because of their reputation, more so what sound and direction they most often bring to the table. You see, Jay Joyce is kind of an interesting guy to talk about when talking about producers. He's kind of the middleman when it comes to the talent of Nashville these days. At the tippy top, you have Dave Cobb, the guy who easily makes some of the best albums modern country has ever seen. And at the pitiful bottom, you got Joey Moy, the guy who's made some of the worst albums I've ever seen. Even if he has started to make some pretty good ones. And I'd place Jay Joyce somewhere in between. I take that back, it makes him look bad in comparison to Joey, so more like I'd place him slightly more in the quality of Dave, but not completely there. Admittingly, Jay Joyce is no Dave Cobb in terms of quality output. You're basically comparing DreamWorks to Studio Ghibli. But that doesn't mean he isn't someone special. Because while Dave Cobb has made some of the most beloved country albums in general, Jay Joyce has made many of the most beloved mainstream records in recent memory. Like seriously, many of the up-and-coming trendy talents you see these days, chances are, Jay's helming their production. The dude's known for giving country-esque stars a balanced rock-oriented edge. And I end up really liking a lot of them in contrast to so many of the other forgettable producers going around today. Big Loud as an entire studio has been pushing a more countrified identity, but Jay Joyce has been doing that single-handedly with his production, which is so much less talked about in contrast to the glory of Cobb and the sheer hate fest of Joey. I don't love everything he does, but most often it's really good albums that become mainstays for me for so many years. So I thought I'd dedicate today to rank everything he's produced, from his best, to his forgettable, to his worst. So let's dive right in.
This is a man that knows how to marry his cousin.
What the hell is this? Like, come on, Jay. Now look, normally I don't say this, and I'm shocked I have to admit this, but Ruthless, while an utterly garbage album filled with unbelievably awkward, terrible writing, one of the most soul-sucking vocal performances I've ever seen, is a rare exception where the producer is the worst part of the album. And if you're familiar with this album, you're questioning, how is that possible? And at least to me, it's because it actually enhances the other seemingly worst traits this album has. Because the entire atmosphere and textures of this record feel slimy and give off a sense of blah so repulsive that it needs to be seen to be believed. Which makes things such as the horrible performance by Gary Allen so much more noticeable. Like with Things That Can't Be Undone, it was an album with also not good vocals, but the production was still pretty good for what it's worth. And here, when your foundation is shit, everything above it turns to shit. Or in this album's case, even more shit because what's stacked above it is also worthless. This gray, dull wall of sound on the entire album is so ungodly annoying. The audio quality of the backup vocals on Slide is just insufferable, and the mixing of the percussion just overpowers Gary. I don't know why, but Jay just really dropped the ball with the production on this one. And to his credit, he isn't the only awful thing about this album. Like I said, Gary is still really bad here. He sounds old, but not in a charming way. His voice feels devoid of any personality. The album itself is weirdly sexual for some reason. Like, nearly every song on here is about sex in some shape or form. All culminating to the horrible song about sex cleverly titled, Sex. In all capitals. While Am I the Only One I recognize as the critical worst song of last year, it's this one that I hate the most for its weird implications in the lyrics. Absolutely terrible marketing for a subject presented so uncomfortably. It isn't Jay's only low, but it's certainly the lowest he's ever gotten by a considerable margin. Thankfully, it's his only terrible one, of which Joey Moy has like a large handful. So let's keep moving forward, shall we?
And that DVD is not even the real film! It's some mockbuster from the bargain bin!
Yeah, there's no sugarcoating this. It Goes Like This is just bad. I know there's some songs on this people like to flock towards and point to and say, Thomas Rhett was actually pretty good in hindsight when looking at his old material in comparison to his new stuff, and really, no. It's still just as bad now as it was then. It's just less annoying than Thomas today. And I will say, this album isn't trying to be a self-congratulatory experience that thinks it's better than it actually is. It's definitely a small-minded album that goes for a pretty laid-back charm. Does it actually land a solid depiction of these aspirations?
No.
The songwriting still reeks of that corporate tone a lot of the early 2010s was, and Thomas himself really feels like he tries to be Eric Church, and I know he was a massive influence on the guy, but here, this feels like you want to be him rather than be like him. Because there's a lot of artists who take inspiration from Church yet feel incredibly unique themselves. And with Red, his dialect and inflections are just too similar to Church and are obviously far inferior. And we know this is just cosplay because never again does he attempt to sound like him from Tangled Up and onward. You can either blame that on Rhett, or you can even blame it on Jay because he well established himself as the producer for Eric. Even taking that out of context, it has some real stinkers. Front Porch Junkies is horrible, and the remix that made it onto the final release doesn't make it any better. All American Middle Class White Boy is kind of embarrassing and probably the biggest thing I cringe to while listening to all these albums. Beer with Jesus is good, and probably the only thing that kept this from being a 3 out of 10 instead of a 4 out of 10. Even when Thomas was at his most quote-unquote country, he was still just as unlikable musically and just as fake authentically. Moral of the story, just don't listen to Thomas Rhett.
You're boring! You're fucking boring, Steve! And the only thing keeping us together is inertia, and I feel more attachment to this disposable fork than I do to you!
Hey everyone, it's Lanko. Remember them? Anyone? Anyone? They made that one good song and their career dipped? Yeah, talk about a bunch of wasted potential. Greatest Love Story isn't just another pretty decent radio single you find amongst mediocrity. It is the holy grail of love songs during the latter half of the decade for mainstream radio. It's so well told, so well produced, that it makes you kind of forget how forgettably bad the rest of the album is. It isn't even, yeah, there's some other really good songs on the album. The rest of it is legit the same amount of uninteresting mid-tempo summer jams you've seen done by much more experienced artists. They opt for this weird pop rock fusion that doesn't really land for me. The usage of synths just makes you wonder, what kind of vibe were these songs going for? Because the lyricism is so bland and vague, you can't really get invested in any of what these songs are saying. The writing, the musical quality, and dare I say, even the performance just doesn't evoke any strong feelings for pretty much anything. It's just drowning in how tepid all of it is. Like I said, Greatest Love Story is the exception. It's a truly amazing and beautiful song that the group just never lived up to. Only reason this is above It Goes Like This is because I like this song a lot more than Beer with Jesus. If it didn't have it, I'd probably switch them. I almost feel bad for them, but given how they've pretty much missed the mark every step of the way, should I? If you want a good version of Lanko, I'd just check out American Aquarium. They're a much more investing band in every avenue. And I don't think anyone will miss them, no matter how amazing and nostalgic their one hit was. Thankfully, that's the last genuinely bad album from Jay Joyce, and compared to the last ranking where I was stuck 50% of the time through bad music, I think that just goes to show how good Jay Joyce is.
I don't like sand. It's coarse, rough and irritating, and it gets everywhere.
Set You Free wasn't horrible, I'm impressed, especially considering how bad things went after this one. But I'm not giving this one too much credit. By all means, this is still a pretty mediocre album. It's mostly just a remnant of lame 2000s radio music, and its emotional scale is shockingly minimal. But Gary's performance is actually quite enjoyable, and the way he delivers, especially at cadences, is quite entertaining. I know everybody loves Every Storm Runs Out of Rain, but I'm sorry, I could care less about the song. It isn't that well written, and melodically, it isn't as gripping as many have told me it was. The concept is admirable, sure, but it's put through such an uninteresting lens that it kind of sucks me out of it and diminishes whatever potential it had. There's a few songs I like, such as Sand in My Soul, which is actually pretty unique, and I enjoy how much it goes for a completely different vibe than the rest of the samey material that plagues the album. You Without Me has some nice steel. Look, this is a perfectly fine album for radio, but for someone who hasn't touched radio in years, this album mostly just does nothing for me, and neither does Gary Allen in general. If you enjoy him, good for you. I don't care. I'm gonna be honest, I forgot this album even existed. It's in a weird blip point between the moment people really began to notice Carrie Underwood was falling off and the moment where she absolutely fell off. So there's not much to talk about with the point in between. The only thing I will give credit to this album is that it's listenable, but not particularly desirable. Especially in the melodic arrangements, it's overly repetitive and feels so dated to the diva pop era of the 2000s. And not in a fun, OMG, this is so nostalgic feeling, and more so in a, oh my god, can you please move on to modern standards, this is boring. Dirty Laundry on Paper sounds cool, but it's put through such a trite lens it becomes absolutely worthless. Even songs with actually compelling setups, they just don't have much meat in the writing. For example, with Like I'll Never Love You Again, it actually sounds mildly interesting. Oh my god, am I actually gonna get a really good song? And the depth of the story is practically non-existent, and I get absolutely no investment in it whatsoever. I don't find this album's overall quality infuriating, just mildly annoying, because it's clear there's potential to a lot of this album, but it chooses to take the easy pass so often I just give up trying to hope it'll be better. Kind of like my opinion of Carrie in general. Thankfully, this is the first and last album Jay was a part of with Carrie, and got off that mediocre ship as soon as he could. Dark Horse was surprisingly decent, color me shocked. In an age where most pop country was bland and offensive material solely created to earn a profit, this one kinda sets itself apart from the crowd. It has a unique vibe for the most part, and Devin's charisma actually shines through quite a bit. All on Me is a jam and a half, and the fluidity of the chorus is super neat, and the songs go for a more serious tone that I think mostly works. Devin kind of reminds me of Hardy mixed with Sam Hunt, which you'd think wouldn't blend at all, and not only does it, it just actually works to his strengths a lot of the time. But not to oversell this, like I said, it's just decent. While I think this album has a lot of things going for it, the songwriting and melodies are where it mostly loses me, especially a solid middle chunk of the album. Dawson is a strong vocalizer, but some of these melodies just get overly repetitive to the point where they stick out way too much in context to the highs of this record. And even some of the songwriting causes most of the emotional beats to fall flat. I definitely see potential in the guy, and he did quite a bit to set himself apart from his contemporaries, but I personally think he didn't go far enough.
I am dead inside.
Now look, if I was ranking this by how much these albums interest me, rather than me trying to be as critically and objective as possible, I would rank these albums way closer to the bottom. I must emphasize this. I do not hate these albums, but as someone who does acknowledge his pet peeves and biases, I'm just gonna come out and say it regardless of their quality. I do not like Little Big Town. Yeah, I don't know, they just don't do anything for me. Similar to Thomas Rhett, I just hate groups when they act like they're so deep, profound, and mature, and their emotional layering and depth is about as deep as a puddle. So as you can assume, I don't really like any of the three Jay Joyce produced albums. But sadly, while I don't really like them, I must fully acknowledge that they are indeed okay. The vocal talent is all over the place, but it's mostly fine. I don't remember their names and don't care enough to look them up, but brunette haired lady was the best, the blonde haired lady was the worst, and the two guys were kinda adequate, I guess. And yes, I do have a ranking for the albums, even if I do think they're kinda on the same level of blah. First album. Painkiller is the one that definitely felt like Grammy bait. They mostly tried with Girl Crush, which is a very good song, but that's solely due to the inclusion of Lori McKenna. And the same applies for Tumble and Fall, along with Save Your Sin. These songs are the most interesting with what they're saying and feel straight out of a Lori McKenna album, only done way weaker. The rest of the album doesn't come close to their quality and just keeps chasing those highs they can never live up to. Puts through a mostly washed up production style that feels like overwhelming neon. Second album. The Breaker is an album that mostly succeeds in taking itself seriously, and the songs actually feel properly weighted with their emotional beats. The problem for me here is that it's sonically forgettable, kind of like that one Lanko album. The beats are mostly lame, the wall of sound feels so tepid, and it's probably the least vocally interesting album, like a shallow U2 emulation. Any song written by Lori McKenna is at least good, and Better Man is a clear standout, but that's about as much credit as I'll give this album. Third album. Tornado is probably the most laid-back album. It's the most bright in tone and energy, and even with the more emotional ballads, they're pretty likable, and I think it's just my bias against them that causes me not to really love this album. It's probably good for you, just not me, so I'd recommend it if you want to listen to the group. The rest of these albums could screw off. They're just Academy bait and don't earn what make award-winning albums such as these so impactful. Thankfully, ever since, Jay Joyce has never worked with them, and I kinda lost all interest in reviewing or listening to any of their music, so I'm finally free. Yay!
You what?!
You're gonna have to bear with me when I rank this album as low as I am. It is not a bad album. I fully acknowledge the artistic worth on an amount of this record, and I just think it's a very overrated album. So with that said, The Outsiders is mostly okay.
Get the f*** out, man!
Yeah, get it out of your systems. But for the most part, The Outsiders is just an album that doesn't really hold up as a collective package in terms of modern standards. Half of this album is kinda garbage, and would probably be close to last place on this list if I split it in two. It's inauthentic to who Eric is, its attempts of experimenting with country and rock mostly do not land at all, and the songwriting is such a complete and utter downgrade for Eric. But that other half of this album, the half I do hold in high regard, honestly would be in the top 5, maybe even the top 3. It's like a beta version of Mr. Misunderstood with incredible power, dramatic tension, and some of the best songwriting modern mainstream has ever seen. And when combining the best and the worst of Eric Church, it turns into such a catastrophic supernova that shakes the earth and heavens, turning into mostly an experience that's pretty okay. The story this album tries to tell isn't as fleshed out as well as it could be, and the album's sonic palette is kinda jarring on re-listen. But man, there's just so much amazing stuff on here that I love that I can't say this album is a dud overall. There's other albums above this one that I think as a collective are better, but I have so much passion for this album that I don't for others, even if I think critically they're superior. With that said, let's keep moving. Alright, we're about to hit the top 20, the actually good albums, the 7 out of 10s and above. Compare this to the Big Loud ranking where less than 10 of them got that rating. Wow. Anyways.
Yeah, I know.
Man, at the beginning of 2021, I never thought Lainey Wilson was going to become the future of country music. She's kind of Miranda Lambert's spiritual successor in contrast to Gabby being Carrie's, and no one really having a strong opinion on either of those two. People love what Lainey's bringing to the table, and for good reason, because this album is good and stuff. As a whole, it isn't mind-blowingly amazing, but it does have some brief moments where I think it does reach that. Things a Man Ought to Know is clearly the fan favorite with its neat little story, but it isn't where the magic of this album ends. Rolling Stone feels ethereal with its fantastic atmosphere. Pipe is pretty funny. Dirty Looks, while a little repetitive, is mostly very well written and melodically very irresistible. The moments where it tries to be something different from most country you've heard before is really great. And when it doesn't do that, I don't really dislike any song on here, but there's some for sure I don't care for or bother revisiting on their own. It's a very solid debut album that just feels a little half-baked in a few areas, but it's still quite enjoyable. She's the future of country music, it seems, and what a bright future indeed.
In love! In love!
Ah yes, the Eric Church album I have the least amount of investment in. It's so weird, because while I acknowledge this album is better than The Outsiders, I don't really care about it nearly as much as The Outsiders. It's just fun music, with nearly all of the substantive, meaty material being trimmed off and it only appearing in maybe one or two songs. Stick That in Your Country Song is an effective protest anthem for substantive writing in country music. I just wish this album adhered to that. Lynyrd Skynyrd-Jones is another one I think that just wants to say far more than the rest, and my thoughts are pretty much exactly the same from over a year ago. Heart is a good heartland rock album with some of the finest musical performances of any Eric Church record. Soul has the potential to be the best with all of the influences and inspiration it takes from soul music, but it's stifled with two of the worst songs Eric has ever done, with Bad Mother Trucker and Break It Kinda Guy, along with And being easily the best, going for that weird left hook we love to see from the Chief with great writing and production to boot. None of these albums work together, but if you ask me, there's enough good in here to keep this shaky project afloat, even if none of it makes sense. This could have easily been 15 tracks of fun, experimental songs from Eric, but there's way too many points where it falls flat on its face to call it overall great. Still a pretty good album, but you wish it had more to it and didn't capitalize on all of its potential as it could have. There's a reason it's considered the most forgettable Eric Church album, and that reason, of course, is this forgettable font. Like, come on, seriously. Every memorable Eric Church album has a cool font. Sinners, Carolina, Mr. Misunderstood, Desperate Man. Look at these fonts. They're super cool. And look at this. Are you really gonna tell me they couldn't get a better, more memorable font? This is truly what ruined Heart and Soul. It ruined the sanctity of it. I don't even know what I'm doing anymore. Let's move on. Skeletons is kind of in the same boat as Heart and Soul. After following one of their most artistic ventures to date, this one just finds them getting way too wrapped up in the musical side and forget what made those albums as fantastic as they were. That's not to say it's bad or anything, I still like it, but given what you know an artist is capable of, getting something lesser than that makes you feel a little ripped off. It's kind of an aimless project in contrast to the last album. You'd think with a title like Skeletons, this would be an album taking on uncomfortable truths or inner demons, but it's mostly just gritty musicality mixed with some mess stories. The guitar work of John Osborne is still very good. It's not quite as amazing as Pawn Shop or Port St. Joe, but it still brings its own personality to the album's overall vibe, especially on the strictly instrumental portions. I think it's the songwriting where the album really loses me. There's some standouts like Skeletons, but the rest of it just goes through the motions and is not nearly as interesting as the stories of their actual masterpiece. But I'm just underwhelmed, even if the good stuff about this duo is still there, and a sizable amount of what is, isn't. I like it, but that's about it.
Jake, you drive a hard burger.
I'm sorry if this comes as a surprise, but up till now, I have yet to listen to an Emmylou Harris album. But I checked out All I Intended to Be After, and that one was great. With that said, Hard Bargain is pretty good. I'm curious if Harris was an inspiration for Morgan Wade, because good God, this album is a lot like Reckless. From alt-rock and folkish vibes, these feel like direct inspirations for Wade over 10 years later. Personally, I prefer what Morgan Wade did in the future, but it's neat here as well. It's not quite country similar to Reckless, but it has its moments here and there. While I prefer the writing of Wade, I will say this is a much better produced album. It carries a more haunting and grand atmosphere, and if I were ranking this solely on production quality, this would definitely be in the top 10. As for the quality of the individual tracks, admittingly, the album in the beginning isn't really that impressive, and it isn't until the late middle and the final chunk where the album gets legitimately great in my eyes. Basically, from Lonely Girl and onward is what I'd recommend. I like Harris's voice overall, and it greatly enhances the overall enigmatic tone of the album. I just think it takes a while to get going, but when it does, it's truly magical.
A duck walked up to a lemonade stand, and he said to the man, run in the stand.
Tennille Towns is an interesting player in today's world of modern country. She isn't a rising superstar like Carly Pearce or Lainey Wilson, but she manages to put out solid numbers, amass a pretty dedicated following, and gain some minor critical success. And deservedly so, if not more, because her debut album, The Lemonade Stand? Yeah, this is a pretty good album. It's definitely become a fan favorite sleeper, taking most of its influence from 80s pop rock, really giving it that authentic nostalgic factor from Holding Out for the One, Lighthouse, to probably my favorite track, Somebody's Daughter, which is a story surrounded around speculation of a homeless person, not in any demeaning way of course, but of a place of empathy and understanding, and its various nuances deserve far more credit than they're given. Tennille's unique voice really sells a lot of the more varied and complex emotions, such as the closing track, while also fitting the super fun bangers the album has. It's very, very good comfort food, but don't just take my word for it. Talk to the number one Tennille Towns fan, Jaren.
Hey guys, Jaren here. Cyrus asked me to give a little input on the Tennille section of his J. Joyce video, given that I'm a pretty big fan of Tennille Towns and what she does. And I wanted to kind of talk about how one of my favorite things about the Lemonade Stand is how, yeah, it's pop country, but it stands out among the rest because I think it's more personal, it's more real. I think the instrumentation is more unique here. And while it's not a perfect album, definitely not, but I think Tennille really shines with songs like Somebody's Daughter or Where You Are or Jersey on the Wall or The Most Beautiful Things, because she's able to kind of give you a look into her life and these doubts that she has or these things she's experienced. And these songs, I think, are very fascinating. Some of them are very wall, or like Holding Out for the One is about how she's not in a relationship because she's being patient and she feels like she should, and she's going to find the one, like her soulmate. And whether or not you believe in soulmates, I think that's a cool, maybe relatable kind of feeling. And I think that's where a lot of her success comes from, is that she's just genuine. She's genuine in real life. She comes across as very sincere in her music and across social media. And she's just an awesome person, and this album, I think, conveys that. She is just a genuine good force in the world.
Yep, it's cool. Tenille's cool. Just because it's ranked number 16 doesn't make it any less cool. Check it out.
This is Barely Legal Pod.
Someone call Brothers Osborne. Country duo debut albums aren't supposed to be really good that establish a compelling dynamic between the two and make music that speaks to them as individuals. It's supposed to be commercial junk. It's supposed to be tasteless and create a negatively impacting legacy. Seriously though, this is a surprisingly solid debut album. Like, one of the best. Not so much in quality, but more so in establishing who exactly the Brothers Osborne are and what their appeal and ambitions are. Most duos are just, here, we got the lead singer, but we need someone to sing harmony. Here you go, bop. But with Brothers Osborne, while that relationship is still there with TJ on lead, that isn't even what their dynamic is about. It's about TJ's smooth baritone delivery in contrast to John's sick guitar skills, which haven't flourished into their peak yet, but you can definitely see the all-star potential with songs like Stay a Little Longer, Loving Me Back, American Crazy. John does bring some solid backup vocals, but it's clear his guitar work is where he shines. The folk rock nature of the album is something I love, even if it isn't super consistent as Port St. Joe. The songs combine modern contemporary with its retro rock really well. I like every song, which are all bangers. It's a really good album while being an amazing debut, and planted the seed which would evolve into arguably the best country duo of the modern age.
Because I cut the brakes! Wildcard, bitches! Yeah!
Wildcard is such a weird album to talk about, because I feel like it simultaneously gets better and slightly worse at the same time with every listen I give it. I think of it less as pop country and more so Texas pop, because good god, the Texas influences are everywhere. From the percussion to the songwriting, its overall tone just screams Texas, just under a pop rock aesthetic. This album has problems for sure. I'm not too big on the album's singles and pre-releases. It'll All Come Out in the Wash and We're Too Pretty for Prison are literally the same song and You Can't Change My Mind. I've never gotten the hype for Bluebird, and while Settling Down was good, it was clearly just C-tier Miranda. And it's certainly one of Jay's weaker albums from a production standpoint. But that's all the problems I have, and reading the script, oh, here's everything else I like. The rest of it. For the most part, this is just a super well-written album, with the combination of Luke Dick and Natalie Hemby making for such an effective trio. Dare I say, it's better than Weight of These Wings, which has gone on to be her most respected album to date. With songs like Tequila Does and Dark Bars, it more than earns its high quality. It's great that this was truly Miranda's commercial comeback after struggling a little bit in the bro era. But this album re-established her as the premier country woman in today's world. It's fun, creative, definitely flawed, but still very Miranda Lambert.
He said you come from a long line of sinners like me.
Let me tell ya, so many of the albums from my childhood don't hold up. I either outgrew them, or I slowly came to realize I had bad taste in music. But this guy, Eric Church? He came out swinging. Sinners Like Me is such a good debut album and is vastly underappreciated. The singles were really good, it was vastly different from the bleak soccer mom contemporary landscape we seem to be stuck in for a while, and it's probably the most country Eric Church has ever been, pretty much the only country album he's ever done looking back. There's far more abundance in steel, banjo, and fiddle, along with a lot more emphasis on country melodic styles and forms, and the songs for the most part are pretty good. Of course, Lightning is a clear standout and there's nothing really close to its level, which may be good or bad depending on what type of person you are, but the album is still good without it. It's just mostly fun, wacky shenanigans with little glimmers of what would manifest into peak Eric Church. Two Pink Lines is one of the better pregnancy songs I've seen, and kinda ditches the serious nature in hand for some pretty good comedic timing. The self-titled track is a pretty good anthem. I get a lot of fun out of these boots, and are we not gonna question what Eric was singing about in How About You, or... Needless to say, I had a lot of fun re-listening. It's just barrels of fun, wacky material with a solid emotional core at the center. It's not the Eric Church album I dropped dead to listen to, but I have a fondness to it after all this time. He came out swinging with his, at the time, unique energy, and in my eyes, it holds up a lot. Carolina is a super good album. I've already dedicated a whole video to it, so I don't want to get too much into it. I admire that it goes for a platonic love route rather than the usual romantic one. It makes this album explore far more areas than just simple romantic love and heartbreak. Its song really delves into its southern rock country fusion, which everyone would adore on Chief, and as a whole, while it doesn't have anything that brings the house down like other albums, it certainly is one of his most quality, consistent records. It's absolutely ludicrous that this man puts mustard on his fries, retroactively bringing this score from an 8 down to a 7. If Eric was a sane man, this would have been in the top 10, but oh well, what are you gonna do? Album's still super good though. Give it a listen. I'm surprised I went this long without even mentioning the Randy Rogers Band, but yeah, these guys make pretty good music. Especially when Randy teams up with Wade Bowen. This surprisingly leaned into the more punkish side way more than I anticipated. One More Sad Song and Speak of the Devil are basically just punk rock songs with some country instrumentals here and there, and it kinda works, what can I say? There's still some country-defined tracks like Flash Flood, but it's clear this album wants to be more than just strictly country and opts out for its more punkish rock tendencies, which are surprisingly likable to me, especially given how much flack I give artists like Cole and Colby. Ideally, this is the country punk I can get behind because its music is not just bland sounds, but creative in so many ways and actively says something rather than just act like it does but says nothing by the end. And it's clear the world wasn't ready for what they were bringing to the table, because if this music came out today, I have no doubt it would have the same cult following Coe Wetzel does. And it deserves far more because this is way better than any Coe Wetzel album. But if you're someone who likes the country punk scene of Coe and Bailey, I definitely recommend checking this out because I have no doubt you'll enjoy this just as much, if not more. Okay, we're hitting the top 10. The 8 out of 10s and above. I find it interesting that on my Big Loud ranking, the top 10 was practically 7 out of 10 and above, and my Dave Cobb ranking was 9 out of 10 and above. Kinda shows the quality spectrum of these three producers, if you ask me. Let's keep moving. I might get a little heat for placing this as low as I am, but I think that just goes to show how great some of these albums are. Your Life is a Record at number 10 is nothing to sneeze at. This is such a well-written album with clever metaphors, melancholy tone, and variety in the ways it displays its core message. I'll Be the Sad Song is such a perfect opener to this album, establishing our relation and connection to music through our emotional and mental states. Love of the Fire is gorgeously enigmatic, Pawn Shop is so grand and allows its story to get its proper weight. The sound of this album is given an almost cosmic effect, really detaching itself from the more rugged nature of her previous albums. My only problem with this album is that it slowly gets weaker as it goes along. It starts out fantastic, but by the time we get to this weird Pixar ripoff song, I'm getting less and less interested the more it goes along, with weaker performances from Brandy to some questionable production choices by Jay himself, to a point where I'd say the album becomes kinda boring by the end. Like I said, it's gradual and not immediately going down a slippery slope, as I still enjoy Bad Car quite a bit. But eventually, the details pile up, turning this from an utterly amazing album through its beginning to mostly great by the end. Aside from its weird quality pacing, it's such a well-tuned record on the writing side, and Brandy still sounds as awesome as usual. Despite this being her weakest album, it's still super great, and that's insanely impressive given some of my other favorite artists' really bad lows. I know my rant on the album's latter half dissuades you from checking it out, but I implore you to do the opposite, as Brandy is so underrated in the mainstream and is easily one of, and you can actually argue, the best in today's era. Pretty Kino album, if I do say so myself. If there's ever been an album that had a redemption arc from being utterly despised to utterly adored in country today, I can still remember everyone hating on this record, calling it out for its major emphasis on southern rock, its literal ditching of Eric's country roots, and overall vibe not fitting the country music brand. This album was pretty trashed back in the day, but thankfully, times change, and this album has become pretty appreciated over the years. I know many blame it for the bro country sound becoming mainstream. Not saying Chief was a bro country album, just that its ability to win over the masses with a more rock-oriented sound contributed greatly to all the shitty Jason Aldean and Gerard Neiman songs we were forced to inject ourselves with. The album's wild nature, in contrast to the mostly corporate acts of the time, make it stand out so much. And nothing about this album really feels dated, especially with the more rock-oriented sound making a comeback. But that's enough rambling about the album's impact and legacy. The actual quality of the record is super solid. Despite many of the songs not being super serious on the surface, they're still very clever and insanely fun, and is such a perfect example of a casual country album maximizing nearly every front and not having any weak links. Despite its intensity, Jay's production is mostly full of balance and great texture, and it allows the calmer moments by contrast to really show how good Jay is with the atmosphere like on Springsteen, and its spectacular nostalgic effect in Over When It's Over's soothing side. The album is definitely more rugged than Charmed, but I don't think it would be quite as memorable if it was the other way around. You need that gritty nature to help bring you into the more nuanced sides of Eric. Even still, the emotional moments such as Like Jesus Does and the God-tier single of Springsteen are so amazing and so well written. Probably my only problem with this album is the racial implication of Homeboy, which, yeah, But besides that, the album is super great and deserves more respect. Sorry, Americana stands, but I love Chief and you can't stop me.
Not bad for a girl going nowhere.
Holy shit, I love Girl Going Nowhere. This is the one scenario where I say, ignore where it's placed, and just listen to this. It's arguably life-changing. The whole album plays out like a road trip with you going town to town, interstate exits taking you to new experiences and life-changing moments. And it feels like an album designated for the road with its soaring rock anthems like Radioland, which captures a feeling of sticking your head out of a car. To its sadder moments like Little Dive Bar, which, well, give off the feeling of entering a dive bar, or in my case a road stop diner since I don't drink. The album's variety and tone is neat and never loses its thematic and atmospheric consistency. Southern Babylon and The Jacket give off completely different vibes but still feel like they came from the same album. It has so many strengths that I adore, from the writing, the inspiring message, the great atmosphere, and overall cohesion, that it pains me to say, yeah, this album isn't perfect. This is certainly an album I love more than I respect, because there's definitely a few parts that just don't land for me. One thing is, this album isn't all that well produced. Specifically in the mixing, with the guitars drowning out the bass way too often and the percussion levels just turned up way too high, making it a little difficult to love the sentimental moments as much as possible. Even Ashley's performance feels a little bit too stoic for my personal liking, and I mostly blame Jay for not really being able to capture all that great vocalization because it's kinda drowned out half of the time. But there's just so much good shit in here that I love that I can mostly look past all that. This isn't like The Outsiders, where all the bad music makes it very hard to enjoy the album as a collective. These are still very, very good songs, just poorly managed, that's all. If you can look past the production problems, this is a stunning record that I can't implore you to listen to enough.
I just want to know who could have done something like this. It's a travesty.
I did. You see this knife and all the blood on it? Here's my fingerprint.
Remember when I said the production of Girl Going Nowhere was the problem? Welp, all the problems are fixed here. Never Will is such a major step up from a production standpoint. Not to say the rest was a step down, but it's mostly the same level of quality, and its placement here is solely due to the production just being better. Because apart from that, I kinda love these albums both equally. Never Will certainly doesn't carry the same thematic weight of Nowhere, but I will say it has higher highs. Sparrow and Stone are both emotional ballads that hit very hard for very different reasons. Sparrow's incredible grandeur and thundering buildup, and Stone's calm yet emotionally driven lyricism. Both are spectacular and probably my two favorite songs of hers. Girl Going Nowhere to me seemingly was about a young Ashley hitting the road, and this album picks up where she is now. Finally making it, signing a record deal, getting played on radio, displaying her conviction to keep being who she is rather than being who someone in a suit wants her to be. It's a message displayed in so many ways, some crazier than others, but it comes across so potently and dramatically. It also experiments with different audio techniques used by way older music and harbors back to an age of country not many in the mainstream want to revisit. It starts out great with Hangin' There Girl, absolutely soars with its incredible middle, and ends with Styrofoam. Yeah, to this day, I can't explain what this song is. I don't hate it, but what is it? What does it want from me? It's such an enigma of a song that kind of encapsulates the fear of the unknown. You don't quite understand it, but you know it's coming after you and wants to end you. Anyway, super great album. Love it to death. Goodbye.
Tell Sugar Daddy what's wrong.
Please don't call yourself that ever again.
I will forever stand Desperate Man to the day I die, and none of you can stop me. Seriously, I do not understand how this album is mid for some people. It's another out of left field sonic swing with incredible homages to classic rock and soul. I absolutely love when artists get weird and wild with their music, and this is no exception. Eric just goes off vocally with some truly creepy inflections and unorthodox progressions, making it stand out not just against its musical peers of 2018, but Eric's entire discography in general. And I'd argue it seems a parental responsibility responsibility are presented even stronger than Mr. Misunderstood, with songs like Some of It, Monsters, Hippie Radio presenting an aged chief giving what he knows to his children, advice on love, his upbringing, adoration for music, and his faith in God. And it's so expertly presented and defined, bringing this phase of his life to such a fantastic end, with his life as a father and performer seemingly reaching a healthy balance. Some songs don't contribute to this overall message, but they're still pretty great. The Snake is a good middle ground political take, Jukebox in a Bar ramps up the pitiful sorrow, and the bops of Hanging Around and Desperate Man are just irresistible. I think if it were a bit more focused conceptually, this might have made the top 3, rather than being a little too loose for my liking. The songs as a collective in terms of their quality are extremely great, but when combined side to side, it's not the most spectacular sum of their parts. Still, there's just so many individual aspects about this album that I love to death and more than justifies this high of a placement. After making what became his magnum opus, this is more than a worthy follow-up that expands upon its spectacular foundation, and it should definitely be more appreciated as one of the best of 2018, especially considering the lukewarm response to Heart and Soul. This is a godsend, especially compared to how disappointing a lot of the follow-ups have been as of recently. Fire up Spotify or Apple Music. You won't regret it.
You looking for the Smiths? Okay, you go down on 5th. If you've hit the funeral home, you've gone too far, so turn around at the Mickey D's.
You ever just find a record and think, I'm in this album and I don't like it? Well, that's how I feel about Big Day in a Small Town. I don't think any album in my lifetime really captures growing up this accurately and well quite like this one. Not only does it portray people trying to make it big in the world and chase their dreams, only for said dreams to kind of wither away as you're forced to settle in a place you vowed to leave, it captures everything about living in a small town. From the superstitions, the spreading of rumors and wild tales, how it initially seems wacky but fragmented. Three Kids, No Husband is a subtly heartbreaking song about a mother being pushed and pushed while feeling completely alone. It's a beautiful concept-like record full of joys and happiness mixed in with the terrors of feeling trapped. It isn't quite as narratively strong as a concept record, but it certainly moves things pretty well track to track. And musically, it captures that suburban charm pretty much near perfect, making stories like Daughter, Soap Opera, and You Can't Come Over putting you in the place and perspectives they represent. The karma of Daughter and the rebellious phase of children's life. Soap Opera's theatrical opening introducing us to this world of kooky characters. And You Can't Come Over showing the dangers of an old flame. Broke is surprisingly very well written with how laid back it is, despite it being pretty serious when looking upon it at face value. Big Day in a Small Town accurately captures the loss of ambition, yet highlights the subtle joys of where we are despite that. My only real issue isn't even that big, I just think it's more contemporary moments like Girl Next Door just don't really jive with the rest of the album. And similar with Girl Going Nowhere, some of the production I'm not a fan of. And I feel like if this was produced by Cobb, similar to Brandy's track on Southern Family, this would be even more fantastic than it already is. That said, it's so gosh darn great in so many other ways, tying back to Brandy herself, and how it portrays small town culture, and how it's not just something inherently broken and looked down upon, and shows its softer sides, acknowledging the brokenness, but showing us what's beyond the inherent structure. It's truly Brandy Clark at her best. Are we finally ready to acknowledge the supreme talent that is Brandy Carlile? There is not a single album of hers that I don't love, with Bear Creek up there as one of her best. And arguably, it's her most country-oriented project to date. The abundance of rootsier and rustic arrangements are far more prevalent than her more rock-oriented work of today. It's not particularly focused on any one narrative, and more so focused on these compelling slice-of-life human experiences. From growing up, to making it in the world as a woman, to acknowledging the moral ambiguity of your violent actions. Yeah, this album really jumps tones quite a bit, sometimes not the smoothest way possible, extending to struggles with faith in both a higher power and ourselves, confronting our own morality. Some of the subjects' weight can feel like a two-ton truck, and it's all presented in such a charming, rustic lens, which makes the more existential songs come down easier. Not like they're simple in execution, I just mean its pleasant presentation makes the gravitas of the writing easier to take in. Speaking of which, its writing is phenomenal, like in a league of its own. Aside from one album, I think it has the best writing on anything on this list. Of course, because it comes from an act such as Carlile whose creativity isn't tied down, but even by her own standards, she really outdid herself with the phrasing, the wordplay, and unorthodox lyrical vocabulary. It's not all very complex. You got simple songs like Heart's Content, which might be the most adorable love song of the decade. It's one of my most played songs in recent time. It's just so catchy. Brandy, as usual, gives it her all in the vocal department. Not quite her best from that standpoint, but a B-tier A-tier performance for Brandy is like an S-tier performance for practically anyone here on this ranking. I think you can argue its incoherent lyrical tone is an issue, but I don't really see it that way. More so as a culmination of just living an authentic life and staying true to yourself, not really bound by anything but wherever it takes you. It's not quite perfect. I do believe some of the more rock-oriented tracks feel too similar from a composition standpoint, nor do they offer as much value as more of the acoustically driven ones. Still, considering the problems of this one to other albums, yeah, I can't complain much. In summary, Brandy Carlile rocks, and Jason Aldean's career can die and stuff. Thank you, bye! Apple body jeans and the boots with the fur. Yeah, the whole damn club, they was looking at her. For too long, I have not sung its praises. For too long, I have not been able to explain what makes this album truly magnificent. But no more. It's finally time. Yeah, Port St. Joe is just shockingly spectacular. I can't believe I've gone this long without talking about it, but it just expands on everything that makes this duo as good as they are. From their southern rock flair, to their great vocals, in contrast to the great guitar work, and a larger emotional core to their music. But even with them giving it their all, I'd actually say the true star of the show is Jay Joyce himself, who truly mastered proper aesthetic and atmosphere on this album. It feels like you're on the shores of Port St. Joe with the brothers, with the waves at your feet and the gorgeous sunset in your eyes. Most beach country kind of misses this fundamental aspect in making their music, often just opting out for tropical sounds that feel stifled by a studio environment. But here, the atmosphere just breathes beyond that, allowing for some of the dreamy-like instrumentals of Weed, Whiskey, and Willie and a little bit of Trouble to fully immerse yourself in the magic. Like seriously, Jay truly outdid himself on the production end, it's just magical. And Jay isn't the only magnificent one at work. TJ's baritone vocals are seriously underappreciated in how they portray the more fun and painful sides of the record. The album also sees them throwing the radio-friendly side of them away, with John going absolutely wild in the instrumental department with the variety of guitar and the insane solo sections. All of these fantastic pieces come together to form something so utterly fresh and innovative for today's world of country. It starts out fun and ends practically near perfectly with While You Still Can, representing the sun falling down on a beautiful day at Port St. Joe. I know I'm like the only person who puts this album on this high of a pedestal, but I will not compromise on this. Port St. Joe is nothing short of an excellent album on all fronts and deserved album of the year over Golden Hour. I will not change my mind. If you haven't given the duo a chance, this is a great place to start. It's just utter magic that I want more people to appreciate. Every day I wake up and I still can't believe this record exists. It really shouldn't, with just how utterly spectacular it is. A mainstream album isn't supposed to have classic influences that date back to the 60s. A mainstream album isn't supposed to have near-perfect pacing and progression. They aren't allowed to tell a compelling story of toxicity and slowly overcoming it. They aren't allowed to have writing so emotionally impactful it builds to an utter tearjerker that brings the house down. Simply put, they aren't allowed to be masterpieces, and yet, here it is. As someone who wasn't too big on Orville Peck just a few years ago, I've become a diehard fan thanks to this album. Orville just did a complete 180 on everything I knew about him, giving the best vocal performance pretty much since goddamn Traveler, showing just how much pain drives this album. Its fusions of classic rock and country feel inspired and make for one of the most inventive albums I've heard all year. In a year where being inventive seems to be the norm, this album just sits on top as the king of the hill. The songs range from great to masterful, with not a single miss in the tracklist. They're either super fun, super serious, pretty funny, to utterly tragic. It gives you practically everything you've ever wanted in an album and more. It's a country album I'd pretty much recommend to anyone. I think no matter who you are, you'll at the very least have a good time with it. Please don't avoid it because you think it's just like his old work, which I acknowledge was not for everyone. But Bronco has a way of appealing to everyone, yet using that as a strength rather than a detractor to tell such a powerful tale of heartbreak and moving past it. Jay Joyce deserves so much credit because if I was solely ranking this based on production value, this would probably be number one. Building upon the fantastic production of Port St. Joe and making the album feel so grand and really shows off Orville's incredible vocalization. The only thing that comes to mind on re-listen that mildly bothers me is the weird track placement near the end, but apart from that, I love this album to death, and it's easily my favorite mainstream album this year, and I truly don't see anything topping it. It's vocally awe-inspiring, narratively brilliant, and simply breathtaking. What could possibly top it?
It's time for the moment you've been waiting for!
Yep, no surprises here. No matter how amazing some of these albums were, even if I do recognize other albums' superiority in some individual aspects, there's just no beating the magnum opus. Even taking my favoritism to Eric Church out of the way, Mr. Misunderstood is just too amazing in nearly every way. After the misstep of The Outsiders, Eric Church came back and delivered one of the most iconic and respected albums in modern country history, with far more emphasis on the mature side to Eric than anything he's ever done before, flexing as hard as he can with the writing, truly outdoing his penmanship on so many levels. Even freaking Chattanooga Lucy is super good, even if it kinda doesn't make that much sense on the surface. With 10 tracks, you'd think it would stumble over itself, yet it manages to deliver masterful track after masterful track along with some excellent singles to boot. It's a character study of an individual, someone who isn't perfect, someone who isn't trying to be perfect. Someone who isn't like all the rest and aspires to be the best version of themselves possible, and presents all the layers of humanity for a man growing up and entering society from their younger years, struggles with sins of hatred, temptation, and succumbing to our vulnerabilities, dealing with heartbreak and the eventual journey of fatherhood. A story exemplifying what it means to be misunderstood and finding content and happiness despite that. The amount of layers go far beyond that, it's incredible. It has some of my favorite songs ever, some of the best musicality I've ever seen, and of course, some of the best production ever. No one could have predicted this album's sudden arrival, and no one could have predicted just how much of a staple it would become for country fans worldwide. You'd be pressed against the wall to find an album with this many fantastic tracks front to back. It's truly the best Eric Church album ever made, and frankly, isn't even close. And I'd say the same applies even with the amount of praise I've given to all these albums. Mr. Misunderstood is truly excellent, and I'm never tired of hearing all the captivating words it has to say. It makes me feel happy, it makes me feel compelled, and above all, it makes me feel understood. It's absolutely magnificent to have an album display this much artistic integrity while still being designed for mass appeal and consumption, balancing those two desires practically perfectly. An album that breathes the same value as any masterful indie project yet done by one of Nashville's most popular acts. A rarity I'd only extend to so little albums over the past 15 years. And I think the overall lukewarm response to Heart and Soul kind of proves that people want this out of Eric. An utterly rich and powerful experience capable of changing people's lives. It's undeniably the magnum opus of Eric Church, the magnum opus of Jay Joyce. I'll dedicate a video to it in full discussing its excellence in the future, don't you worry. But for now, enjoy one of the best albums of our lifetime.